Hi, and welcome to this installment of Frank and Mary in Northborough, the COVID-19 version. With me is my wonderful co-host, Chris Lindquist. As you know, the traditionally, the Frank and Mary in Northborough show is designed to help you, especially folks who are seniors who, like Frank and Mary, want to live in their house until they die and stay right here. And is to help you about know about the programs and people you need to know about in order to stay in Northborough and not have to move. And so Chris and I decided to do the COVID-19 series of this because now more than ever, people are really, really at home. A lot of times they're really, you know, they're really being told to stay at home. And so the question is, while you're doing that, what are the special things that you might need to know about? What's going on in town? How can you be kind of accessing resources? And so, of course, Chris has been finding these terrific guests to help you figure all that out. And Chris, today we have a wonderful person. Tell me who is on our show today.
Well, Arthur, we have a premier guest today, a VIP guest, I'll say. So Andy Dowd, who's our town clerk. Andy is, you know, an amazing town clerk. I've worked with Andy, so I've been with the library for about 5 years, and Andy and I have worked together. Obviously, you know, there's a lot happening at Town Hall. Even though the library and the Town Hall are closed to the public, there's a lot happening behind the scenes in order to serve residents. And I know Andy, you know, is on, you know, a few committees and task forces in terms of how the town is responding to the COVID-19 crisis. So I thought Andy would be just a fantastic guest to have on in order to kind of keep residents informed about what's happening behind the scenes.
That's really exciting. So let me just ask Andy, because I'm not from Northborough. Could you just like let the folks, me and the folks at home know? So how long have you been doing this? Where are you from? Are you a Northborough person originally? How did you end up doing this? And are you still loving it? Is this, Andy, still a lot of fun?
Well, certainly it's a lot of fun. And first of all, thank you both for having me. I'm sure I'll enjoy this experience. I've been town clerk in Northborough for almost 16 years now, and I've been employed by the town for almost 34 years. So that means I'm getting up there in age.
That is incredible.
And it also, I think, indicates
So is the bubbler at Town Hall like a fountain of youth bubbler? So you just use it and like you never age?
I'll accept that compliment, but thank you very much. So I've been around a long time. Actually, before my current position as town clerk, I used to work as a public safety dispatcher for the police department in town. So I've had a community connection for a long time. In fact, when I first started in that other job, the police department was located in the town hall building. So I literally came back to where I started back in 1987. And now as town clerk, and it's a job that I love very much, and I enjoy the interaction with the residents and the people in the community, and it's been a very rewarding position.
So just a final question before I know Chris is going to be talking to you about kind of what's going on in town. It has been my experience with town clerks that there are people who they want that job because they just love talking to people. Is this making you crazy? Is this just making you crazy that you're, you know, needing to be remote and you're not seeing people coming in all the time?
It's definitely very challenging. You know, we've been closed to the public since March 16th, and you know, as Chris indicated earlier, you know, we're staff is still in the building, we're still working. You know, many of us are working remotely, alternating for safety reasons. But that direct connection with the residents is definitely something that I miss during these challenging times that we're going through.
So thank you. I was just curious. So Chris, what do you guys know about what's going on in town?
So, you know, I would just want to talk about, Andy, you know, how we are providing services behind the scenes remotely. I mean, the library staff is all working from home. I know most town staff, non-essential employees, are working from home, non-public safety employees. And obviously I believe you're at home today, correct? And so you're trying to provide services remotely. I think you're also a justice of the peace, and I'm not sure how that's working in this environment. So maybe you can talk about public records and you know, people who are requesting access to public records and how the town clerk is responding in this unprecedented time period.
Sure. So we're fortunate, and I'll give myself a bit of credit, that we have so many documents now available electronically, and that includes birth, death, and marriage records that are, you know, readily available, and also they can be ordered online. So if residents need a document like that, they can go to the town's website, they can click on the online services option right on the homepage and make the requests. And of course, those requests are still being handled and the document could be mailed out. We've run across a few situations where people may need an item urgently and they can't wait for the mail. And we certainly make arrangements to, you know, leave items out. You know, we have a box outside the building for pickup, and sometimes just a matter of taping an envelope to the door, that sort of thing, to accommodate residents that need something urgently. But in general, the mail works works very well for things like that. So that's been, we're fortunate that we were already set up to handle that process before this crisis hit us.
Great. And, you know, I know that we don't know when we're going to be reopening to the public. So I know you're also on, I believe, at least one, possibly more committees, task forces that is considering, you know, how we're operating in this environment. You know, can you talk about a little about, you know, and I know you've been coordinating an initiative to kind of help give information about businesses that are operating, whether in person or, you know, perhaps online. And I think there's information now on the town's website, which is an outstanding website and was recently kind of redesigned. And so I know you've had a lot to do with putting information up on the website as well, correct?
Yes, so as you mentioned, I do serve on a couple different groups that have been dealing with this, you know, this current crisis and how the town can respond to it and also operate during it. And, you know, that group meets weekly through, you know, a remote method as we're using today. To keep everyone up to date on the progress and the needs in the community. And as you mentioned, we've spent a lot of time to get information out to the residents through a variety of methods, but certainly the website being the primary method. We've built an entire new web page strictly for COVID-19 information. And that has a wealth of information on it for, you know, both residents and business owners. You know, it has all kinds of resources and links to, you know, information people want, you know, statistical data on, you know, the infection rate, both in the town, statewide, things like that. Lots of resources for businesses that are in need, lots of resources for residents who are in need for unemployment and things like that. And as you mentioned, just recently, we added specifically a listing of Northborough businesses on that site. And that's something, if people want to have their name added to it, they can simply send an email request and that information is readily available on the site. And that way, if someone, we encourage them to support our local businesses and to shop locally. And obviously a lot of them are challenged in their operation right now and they're trying to find ways around, you know, the restaurants are offering simply, you know, just takeout and curbside pickup and that sort of thing. And to get them through this crisis, we're trying to help folks out through that method as well. And like I said, really just getting information out through the website, through the, you know, the cable access TV has been fantastic for folks that may not have internet access at their home. Most of the time they do have cable, hence the reason for this show probably.
Yes.
And the good thing also is that the local media that's still in operation, you know, they pick up on everything we send out on the website, and therefore it also ends up in the paper and in their online presence. So we have a lot of resources out there for residents.
It's a great, go ahead, Arthur.
No, I was just going to mention, I think that's, you know, kind of kudos to Northborough Cable for really stepping up and really trying to provide a lot of this information. Because I think that one of the results of all of this is that I think a lot of people, a lot of seniors, have come to really appreciate the value of having that, especially if you're not, as many of my clients are not, and as I am not, tremendously internet savvy, and you're not crazy about trying to figure out how to get through Facebook and do this and that. You know, to be able to just click on your TV, if you're probably spending quite a bit of time doing that now anyway, you know, and to be able to get all this information is really, it's just terrific. So thank you. So, but could I just ask once again? Now, I'm not living in Northborough, so I'm not familiar with kind of where things are. But I know that spring is usually your busy season, right? Where you've got your town meeting and you've got elections, and you're just a busy guy. And so, for people who have, you know, kind of maybe not haven't seen a lot of this stuff on the internet, can you just talk about how that's going to happen this spring? You know, town meeting and town elections and stuff.
Certainly. So recently the Board of Selectmen met and they made several decisions regarding both the town meeting and the town election. There's been legislation passed by the state that gives towns the ability to postpone those events for obvious reasons during the current crisis. So originally our town meeting was supposed to happen on April 27th. That's been postponed to May 27th. And basically that date is just a placeholder at this point because it's the expectation of the Board of Selectmen that they'll likely want to extend the date again beyond that due to the crisis continuing. In this, the state law allows us to postpone for up to 30 days. So that's simply a means to push it out the 30 days initially, and then they're going to revisit that at a meeting sometime soon. As far as the town election, which was scheduled for May 12th originally, that has been postponed to June 30th. That was the latest the law would allow us to postpone because that ends the fiscal year for cities and towns in, I should say towns in Massachusetts. So it'd be the last day we could have the election, and the board felt, and I agreed, that postponing the election to the latest date possible at the very end of June will give us the most time, first of all, to allow folks to apply for a mail-in ballot, which I'll explain in a moment. But also, hopefully, at that point, we'll see some reopening of businesses and some return to normalcy then, where people may feel comfortable to come out physically and vote at the polls that day, which, regardless of what's going on, the polls need to be legally open that day. For a period of time to allow in-person voting, even though folks may choose to vote by mail. And if I could just explain that process quickly, and I want to emphasize that it's very easy to obtain a ballot by mail. The state, again, through that regulation, has allowed all residents to vote early for the local elections in Massachusetts. So there is a form that's posted on our website. It's a very simple form, name, address, and that you'd like the ballot mailed to your home. You do not have to use the form, and that's important to note. So folks, again, that may not be on the computer, have access to the form, you can simply send a note listing your name and address, indicating you'd like a ballot for the town election mailed to your home, and sign it. The signature is key on both the form itself, if they choose to use that, or the simple written request. The regulations do require that the voter sign the request, for obvious reasons, and that can be submitted to us really three different ways. If folks do have the ability to electronically do that, they can scan it. I always tell people frequently, even those that aren't that tech savvy, if you have some sort of a smartphone with camera capabilities, after you filled out that form, take a picture of it, email it to my office. All that information's on the website. That works very well. If that's not an option, you can simply take the form or the written request, mail it to the town hall at 63 Main Street, attention town clerk, that'll get to us no problem. Or a third option for people that may want to just get out of the house is, and this is for a lot of different things, there's a convenient drop box or lock box at town hall. It's accessible 24/7 at the entry door to town hall right off the parking area, where someone could just drop that request in an envelope in the drop box, write town clerk on the outer envelope, it'll get to us, we'll process the request, the ballot gets mailed to them, they vote the ballot, it comes with a return envelope, the same process, you can either mail it back or you could simply bring it and drop it in the drop box. You can't email that ballot back. In this case, you need to physically send the paper ballot at either by mail or put it in the drop box. So it's pretty convenient and fairly simple.
Arthur, can I ask a question of Andy?
Oh, no, anything. I was curious about that. I realized as he was explaining, that was probably part of your list of questions, but as an old politico, and many years ago, I was in the city council here in Marlborough. I'm always fascinated by the process, you know.
So, Andy, there will be actually open voting booths on June 30th And will there be one voting location?
Yes, so the law still requires that the polling place be physically open on that day. That hasn't changed at this point. So if folks do wish to come and vote in person, obviously there will be guidelines on appropriate protection to wear, and also appropriate precautions taken for staff that will be there that day for protecting themselves. The voting location in Northborough had been consolidated last year to one location townwide, so that makes it easy as well. So everyone still goes to the Melican Middle School, that's at 145 Lincoln Street in Northborough, and that's where all four of our voting precincts are located, and they will be there that day. We're still obligated to have the four precincts. You know, you vote at 1, 2, 3, or 4, and they used to be in four elementary schools. So we often reference the old school name to give people a reminder of which precinct they belong at. Obviously, we have people that direct them there. So we'll be equipped to handle folks that choose to come and vote in person. And we certainly understand that some people will definitely prefer to still vote in a traditional manner if they feel safe doing so. And we'll be there ready to handle that.
Great. And also, we're in a presidential election year, so it's hard to believe, but thinking ahead to November, how's all that going to work in this environment, right? And I'm sure town clerks and, you know, you're thinking ahead, right? And
yep.
Do you have any information about the fall election, Andy?
At this point, you know, if you follow the news at all, there have been many proposals already that would allow some type of mail-in voting for everybody for the fall elections. There's another primary in September on September 1st for some statewide offices, you know, to narrow down the field between the two parties. And then, of course, the presidential election on November 3rd. So at this point, that hasn't been decided. I'm almost certain that all voters will likely have the ability to vote by mail in some manner based on the current situation in the country. And knowing that, you know, we may not be out of this for some time, or they talk about spikes and different things that may see a resurgence in the fall. So we obviously have to be prepared for that. I actually serve as the legislative chair for our statewide association, so I'm probably more familiar than most with that, the legislative action that's taking place, and we've had lots of discussions and conversations on how all that would work. And obviously, what we want to ensure is that the process is simple, similar to what I just described for the town election, and then also that there's appropriate capacity so that we can manage the volume, because there will be a significant difference. For example, the town election, you know, if people mail in their ballots, we may get about a 15% turnout, just rough numbers. We always hope to have higher, but that's just the reality of voters. We have a little over 11,000 registered voters in Northborough. You know, in November, we'll have probably 80% of those voters vote.
Right.
So if that's going to happen with a large percentage by mail, we want to make sure that we're equipped and have the appropriate resources and staffing to handle that operation, because that's something we do mail a lot of ballots already to folks that may not be able to get out if they, you know, wish to vote absentee. They're not physically able to get to the polls. But typically that number is not that high. So it would take quite a bit of work on our end to get that processed and have it done, you know, correctly and efficiently.
And isn't it also true, Andy, that early voting is kind of trending anyway? So you had already seen kind of, you know, an increase in early voting in prior elections recently?
Yeah, so starting back in 2016 for the November elections, the state of Massachusetts adopted legislation that allowed for early voting for those November elections every 2 years. And that gave residents an opportunity, primarily at that time, to vote in person at town hall. In our situation was the location for the 2 weeks prior to election day. So they could vote early, get it over and done with, and that ballot was counted on election day. That also included an option to make that request by mail, but more typically someone, a voter, would come in and choose to do it in person, because it was very quick. They just came in, checked in off the voter list, voted the ballot, secured an envelope that they had to sign as an affidavit, and they were done. So very simple. So, you know, that option will be there certainly for November, but the issue with mailing those ballots may change dramatically, where we only had literally a handful probably mailed last time, those numbers I expect will increase dramatically, and we need to prepare for that.
Absolutely. A lot of planning and preparation is going in, and I'm sure you're starting now, or you probably started, you know, over the winter, thinking yep. about various scenarios. And I, and on that note, I know, you know, there is an emergency management team. There's a task force, I think, that's being formed about, you know, reopening plans. You know, how are we going to start to reopen to the public at some point? Are you involved in some of those discussions at Town Hall?
Well, we have discussed, as you know, the governor just in recent days, you know, extended the stay-at-home order out to May 18th. In that weekly meeting that we have of our, you know, COVID-19 management team, if you wish to call it, you know, we're obviously discussing that and preparing for, you know, what the state may release at that point as far as what can reopen. And, you know, that may include some public buildings and how we're going to handle that. And the good thing about the same day the governor made that announcement, he indicated he had formed a team basically to look at, you know, what we need in place to allow things to reopen. And I think we're going to get some good guidance from the state. I know Governor Baker's done an excellent job, you know, relaying information and preparing folks and, you know, think progressing very cautiously in an appropriate manner to, you know, to hopefully reopen society in a safe way in Massachusetts. So, but the town will also mirror that. I know the Board of Health is meeting in a few days to review a policy that may require folks to wear a face covering in Northborough, and that's something a lot of communities are doing locally. The Board of Health would have that ability through recent regulations that the Attorney General released, that would be appropriate for them to regulate for obvious reasons. So that's something we're working on too.
Great. Arthur?
That's a ton of information. I know we're getting close to the end of the show, but I just want to go back to an elections, once again, that's my election trivia question. Just sure. so that I'm clear, so that folks are clear, if you are using a mail-in ballot in this in the spring election, the municipal election, June 30th, mm-hmm. does the ballot have to be mailed by June 30th or received by you by June 30th in order to count in the election?
Excellent question. So for the town election on June 30th, we do have to have that ballot back by the close of polls on June 30th for it to be counted. That's what the law allows for. So we need to have received it back by Election Day at the time the polls close. So that's important for people to know, and I'm glad you asked that. As we talked earlier about extending that date as far out as possible, you know, now we have about 2 months for people to, you know, take action, fill out that request, write a note, send it to us. We actually just had the ballots physically come in, so we have them ready to start mailing out. We'll get them mailed out, and I always encourage folks, when you get it, vote it right away, put it in that envelope, and either drive down to Town Hall, pop it in the drop box, or put it in the mail, and that way you know it's back, it'll be received in time, and your vote will be counted, because the last thing we want to see is to have one of those come back, you know, in the days after the election and not have it count.
I know the old political saying was vote early and vote often. So we're not saying vote often, but it would be handy for you to vote early.
We have some pretty good methods to prevent anyone from trying to vote more than once, I can assure you. So.
More than once. Well, Andy, Chris, this is, I'm sorry, yeah. you have a last question?
I just wanted to make one point, Andy. We should probably, for those who aren't aware, maybe they haven't gone to the town's website, we should probably give the address of the town's website.
Oh, very good idea.
Yep, that's a great point, Chris. So the town's website is just www.town.northborough, spelled out with the UGH.MA.US. And right on the homepage, there's a red banner below the Northborough information in the header that has the COVID-19 information. You just click there and it brings you right into that dedicated page with all kinds of information. And within that is the information about the election, a link to that application form for the early voting ballot, the information about the town meeting. There's also information, one thing I didn't mention that's important, the selectmen also took action to allow residents to pay their tax bills a bit later than normal. They were due May 1st, and that was extended out a month. And that was something else the state did by law that gave communities the ability to extend the due date to help folks out during these difficult times. And all that information is on the website.
Right. And also, make sure our terrific Dana Volk, our terrific staff, the producer yes. here. We'll be sure he highlights that on this show so people
and
can.
And one
write
other
that.
Note, if I may, I was just going to say, and people can also sign up for town news, Andy, correct, on the website so they will get regular notifications.
Yes, good point. So if you're on the website, there's a link there to sign up for town news, and what that means is you'll get an email whenever we post anything of importance, or also if you're interested to know when a board or committee may be meeting, things like that. And also, as far as signing up for things, there's a link on the website for Code Red, which is the system the town uses for more emergency-type notifications. And it's important for folks to go on there and make sure their information is registered, so when a notice goes out, they do get it on their home phone, their cell phone, their email, that they stay connected and informed. So that's important.
So Chris, you were absolutely right when you said earlier this week we were talking about who we should have next on the show, and he said,
yes.
"This guy you got to have on right away." I mean, there's a ton of information. It's timely. It's really, really important information, right? You didn't tell me, Chris, that he and I actually wear matching shirts. We actually
yes.
go. Turns out we actually have the same guy for these shirts.
We try to, it's kind of the business casual. We're not wearing sweatpants, or we might be. We don't know. The viewers at
we
home
don't know what
we're wearing, but we try to be presentable. Andy, thank you so much. You're doing a fantastic job. There's so much happening behind the scenes. And, you know, I'm just glad that you were able to join us today to kind of talk about what you're doing, what the town clerk's office is doing, and the information that's available on the town's website. So thanks, Andy.
You're welcome. My pleasure.
It was just great. It was just wonderful, wonderfully helpful. Folks, thank you all for watching. Thanks again to my friend Chris Lindquist. Thanks to our guest, Andy Dowd. We'll see you again on the next installment of Frank and Mary here in Northborough, the COVID-19 series. Thank you very much.